Hello there, friends. In today's episode, I'm going to go through Docker Compose. I'm going to give you a quick heads up as to what it is, how to use it, how it relates to Docker files and stuff. And then we're going to finish up on what the Docker Rails template is and how to use it. So grab your keyboard and let's get ready for a really fun episode. In a previous episode, I kind of explained the Docker file in depth, but just as a reminder, it's a set of instructions to create an image for our app to run in. So for example, this one, I have Ruby version 3.0. I've installed some of the packages required to run my app and install some of the gems. And you may go ahead and install the gems and run yarn and all that stuff and copy the files you may need. So this is a pretty cool way of running applications because I can run Docker Compose run and I can just give it this image name and it'll be like, oh, cool, yeah, here's your application, which is cool. However, if you want to run things like Postgres and Redis, we'll have to run those commands as well. And orchestrating that will be very hard because we'd have to have like separate tabs to run Docker Compose run, all that other stuff. And the way we get around that is we use a Docker Compose file. And what this does is we specify our services and it turns them on at the same time we're turning on our app, which is cool. If this file feels a bit intimidating, don't worry, it is. So I've created a slightly simpler version for us to play around with. So I have my little app here, which is very cool. And all it's doing is saying, give us a service, and that service is Postgres, and use the image of Postgres 13.2, which is cool. And we've also passed it a username and password of Postgres. So let's turn that on and see what happens. So right now on my machine, it says there's no response if I try to connect to Postgres. So if I type docker compose up, this is going to look for that YAML file and it's going to turn on all the services. So you can see it's doing some magic here. And the key thing here is it said down here, we're now ready to accept connections. So if I was to ping this again, see where it still says there's no response. So this is because we haven't given our local machine access to the port which is running on here. So what we could do in this case is not worry about this, and if we had another service it could connect to this quite happily. So the idea is that if you have like lots of apps running on your machine, they can be kind of somewhat isolated. But for this tutorial, I'm going to very quickly uncomment this line here, and I'm going to just say, right, yeah, port 5432, make that available on my host machine. Like let my image, let this image talk to my local machine. Let's do that. So it's going to turn that all on. And we can see now it's ready there to accept connections, which is very cool. So let's go in here. I've got table plus here. And I've got a little connection here to localhost 5432. And if we go in here, we can create a database called like sample, and yeah, there it is. We have a little Postgres connection with a database, which is very nice. Okay, so we have one more problem to solve. So we have our little database here called sample. And if I was to quickly close this, turn off our little machine, and then also type Docker Compose down, so that turns off everything, and then turn it all on again, like this, then reconnect, our database has disappeared. So why did it just disappear? A very fun reason. So these services, the images are inferical, so that means any changes we make to them are not saved. So that probably sounds really annoying. So there's a workaround. So to kind of solve this problem, we create volumes. And volumes are kind of like saying, this folder here on this image, I want you to share it with my local machine. And by doing that, we end up being able to persist data between between like runs of our service. So once I turn it off and on, it can still have the data from before. And if I want to share that data with other services, that's then possible. So let's see what happens. So I'm going to turn this all off again. And I'm going to make sure this is all saved. keep an eye up here. Something's going to appear. So you can see here, a little folder has just appeared, which is very cool. And if I now connect to this, create a database called Sample for Life. You can see we've got a little database here called Sample for Life. So that's in there. And I'm going to quickly close that. I'm going to turn this off, turn it down again, and then turn it up. Okay. See what happens. We still have Sample for Life. So that's very cool. We like that. So that's very nice. So this setup is cool, but you probably don't want to be persisting this folder here in the same folder as your application, because that could get kind of annoying. And also, it's created itself as root on my local machine. This is because like the image runs as root, so it's created the little folder as root. So if I wanted to remove it, it's really hard. I have to use like rm-rf postgres data. It'll be like, oh, I don't have permissions, so I have to use sudo to get rid of it. So that's kind of annoying. So the way we solve this is we just use named volumes. And named volumes are kind of similar to what we were just doing up there, except for it just hides it away. So let's just kind of set that up. So we go volumes down here. We put in the name as Postgres data, like this. And now whenever it sees this kind of name being mentioned, it's just going to link it to this volume here. So let's do Docker compose up. And you can see it's gone ahead and says it's somewhere near the top here. It says I'm going to create this volume of Postgres data. That's cool. So I'm going to quickly go into here. Again, just going to create a new bit of data. Hit in persisted. Let's call this one. It's a nice database name. Cool. I'm going to quickly close this off. Again, turn this all down. Turn it up again. And there we go. Still there. And it's not our little file list on the other side as well. So that's really nice. I like that. So hopefully you're feeling a bit more confident in using these Docker Compose files now. And let's go through this slightly more complicated one. So the first thing we do is we have version 2.4. And we've got this little and app thing. So what we're using that for, it's a little YAML trick. And it's to share configuration between multiple services. So we have like Postgres, we have Redis here, but we also have Web Worker and Webpacker. These are all Rails based, so I want them to kind of share the Rails configuration we've set up. And that is pretty much saying, go build this Docker file here, and it goes through, installs the packages, creates all the folders, and it's pretty nice, and it stops about here. So this is because on local development, we don't really want to have to worry about running bundle and yarn each time. We have a little magic trick to kind of get around that. And we also share some environmental variables, and we have a couple of volumes for performance. So I mentioned that we're going to run bundler in a different way. So we're actually sharing our like local gem cache, the local bundler files even, in a volume. Same with node modules and a few other things. I'm going to go through that in just a moment. So we also have this thing called depends on, where it's kind of going to say, don't start any of these images until we have Postgres running. So let's turn it on and quickly see what will happen. If we do Docker compose build, this is going to go build this little Docker file and get us going. So it's pretty quick. You see, it didn't actually do too much there, but it's all good to go. And if we now go back up here and we run Docker compose run web bin setup, this is going to go into this bin file and run this setup file here. And this is pretty much going through running bundle and yarn and also setting up the database. So what this is pretty much going to do is it's going to turn on our little thing and then open an instance of the web image and then run a command in it. So let's see what that does. It should be pretty quick. Okay, You can see there's a bit of a delay there while it waits for these to turn on. But it's gone through, it's run bundle, and it's run yarn, and we've got all our stuff there. And it's also quickly changed our DB file because it's changed the schema. So that's cool. And if we do Docker Compose up now, it's going to turn on everything. And VS Code said, hey, you got something running on port 3000? And yes, we do. So that's very cool. So we're now running Rails, and we didn't have to install like too much other than Docker, which I really like. Okay, so let's have a little poke around in here. What if we wanted to run a ad hoc command? Or we wanted to see what was going on here. So let's just quickly type docker compose run dash dash rm web. So that's going to go in here. It's going to find this web service, and instead of running this command, which would normally turn on the Rails server, we're just going to run bash, and that's going to give us an instance of this thing to kind of play around in. So you can see it's turned on Postgres and Redis, and we have all our files there. Now, I mentioned earlier we have like some nice volume caching going on here. If we have a look at the node modules up here on the local machine, it's empty. However, if I was to go to node modules on our little Docker image, we have them all there. So this is kind of magic, but it's storing all of our node modules outside of our like app and sharing it between all those services. So we only have to run node once or run yarn once even. And this is very cool. Cool, so let's do something kind of more interesting here. So let's say I wanted to quickly run Rails G scaffold, and let's say, post title string. So nothing too unfamiliar there. We're gonna quickly build some stuff. And I'm gonna quickly hop out of that. Gonna run Docker Compose up again to give us our nice web interface. And we go here. It synced all those new files up to that new machine, and we can run the migration. And there we go. Cool, so that gives us that. We can see that we've got the new files here. So they came from the machine to the little Docker machine to our local machine quite nicely. And it's also able to kind of do the schema stuff to add stuff here. And if I was to kind of go some title, there it is. And if I was to turn this all off again and turn it on again, the data which we just stored in the database there should be all persisted. So let's see what that does while we just wait for it to turn on. There we go. Cool. Fantastic. Yeah, still there. That's pretty awesome. Cool. So that's a very quick rundown on how to use Docker Compose to run Rails. Please make sure to have a quick look at this repository if you want to have a quick more of a dig through how this Docker Compose file works, same with the Docker file, which is up here. And you can clone this down and play around with it, and I highly recommend having a bit of a play, because I really enjoy this, being able to clone something down and just do Docker Compose up and basically have a Rails app ready to go. If you want to dig through even more further, it's actually generated from this repository, the Docker Rails generator, which is just these core files which I put together to like things like the Docker file and the Docker Compose stuff, and they just get copied over a regular little Rails application, and you can even install it on an existing application using that if you want. So I hope you enjoyed this little this run through. I know I really love playing around with Docker Compose. You can do some really cool stuff with it. And I would really love to do like some more in-depth stuff. So hopefully you enjoyed that, and I'll see you next time.